call to order at 7 o'clock to start the pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, first up, we have the citizens forum. Linda, has anyone signed up?
No one has signed up.
Okay, that's good. All right, first up, we have a public hearing. So we have two variances on the agenda for tonight. First, whenever we have a variance request, we allow the public to have an input before we get to that item. So I'm going to open the public hearing for opportunity for citizen comment for requested variance to allow front-facing garage at 631 High Ridge. So does anyone in the audience have anything to say? Got a motion to
motion to close
public hearing. All those in favor?
I need a second.
Second.
Okay. All right. We got a second. And all those in favor? Aye. Thank you. All right. Next up, we have a second public hearing to provide an opportunity to citizen comment on variance for a front facing garage at 409 Peninsula, so opposite side of town. Do I have anyone have any comments? All righty then.
Motion to close the public hearing.
I have a motion to close the public hearing. Do I have a second?
I second.
I have a second. All those in favor? Thank you. All right, then we'll move on to the regular agenda. And Mike Lenz is the first thing up is a variance request. Okay. So we have a variance request for a front-facing garage at 631 High Ridge. This is the Story residence. It's down here on the right-hand side, just past Melody Lane. And Rod, you are going to...
Yes.
Do you want to explain what you're trying to do, or come on up to the podium, Rod?
Yeah, it's a storage building or garage that Terry's wanted to build at the back of his place, and it will have a garage door that will be facing High Ridge.
But how far off? It's behind
the
fence.
It's like 600 feet off of the road.
Right, it's behind the fence, in the trees, behind the woods.
Yeah, it's a 6-foot privacy fence. And actually, if you was to put it to the side of the building to the south, it would be like 100 feet off of
woodcrest,
which would be much more visible.
So Rod is not only the contractor who's going to build it, Rod is actually the next door neighbor.
Live next door to Terry, so I don't have a problem with it, obviously.
Okay. Does anyone else? So typically, when we have like Rod, the Stories have a basketball court in the backyard,
yes.
And they have an outdoor pool, and
yes,
they have an outdoor kitchen. So typically, when we have other things in the backyard, it becomes difficult to side swing over the top of the pool,
yeah,
and things of that nature. So the standing kind of way we've handled these is that as long as that front-facing garage is behind the back line of the house,
and it's well
then
behind.
We don't have a problem. And this is that in that's twice as far back in the trees.
Right.
So
really isn't the main garage. This is an accessory.
No, it's
this
not.
Is really an accessory building that
he's got a 3-car garage on the house.
Yeah.
Yeah, call the garage, it's kind of, yeah. All right.
Behind the fence and everything else. So technically, we asked them to come in and ask for a variance because technically speaking, even though it's 500 feet off, 600 feet off the street, it does face the front.
Does the other slide show the entire lot?
No, I don't think that does. That's the next variance, right?
Okay.
That's where I was trying to get to.
It doesn't show the entire lot. Sorry, I didn't include that.
That's fine.
So,
any other conversation?
Yeah.
Motion to approve the variance for Francis Street Drive.
631
High Ridge.
All right, I have a motion to approve the variance.
I'll second.
Dan seconded. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. All right, the second variance request is for over here at 409 Peninsula. That's Mike Ballman. Mike has built two other houses. He's got one we're doing now on our curve over there on Hillside Peninsula, the curve. And Mike, you
want to? Yeah, basically I'm requesting a side yard variance. The lot really needs to be a front load garage. I mean, you see the width of the the lot that's just very tight to make the radius to turn in and try to accommodate, I guess, the city ordinances for the side load, but there, you need a little more footage on the front side in order to make that really work properly.
What is the...
Looks like this is shown with the side.
Well, you tried the side swing, how far did you make it?
It's only, I got 15...
15 feet out of 28?
Right. So it's just very tight.
Okay.
So where would the, would this be the front?
That'd be the front of the garage, yes.
Okay, so it's the same floor plan that you're moving the door?
Correct.
Okay, and then the drive would be?
Right, the garage would meet the square footage requirements.
Actually becomes a usable driveway too.
Yes.
You have one car there, it's...
Exactly.
And I looked at the plat to see, because when the road curves, you can't have rectangles curving. Somebody's going to be a trapezoid.
Right.
And he ends up being the winner on the curve. So Mike's two next door neighbors both have side entry, but the one on the left is 10 foot wider. It's a rectangle, it's 10 foot wider. The one on the right is 12 foot wider at the back. So it's also wider. All the other lots on the street that are comparable are all front facing. I did talk to the neighbor across the street, the Hunts, who have a front facing garage, and asked them, do they mind looking across the street at a front facing garage? And they said, no, we have a front facing garage. So as far as I know, none of the neighbors, everybody on that street faces front other than your two neighbors
right.
along the wider lots. So it's actually, the side swing is the exception on that street rather than the rule.
Exactly.
And I'd rather have it be front loading than have an inoperable side entrance where you can't get out of your own driveway.
Yeah, but it's much more functional.
Personally, I think the front facing is, my takeaway is not every house is front facing. And in these cases like this, it's the minimum. Yeah, I think it's going to be much more functional to have that driveway there. The only other thing you watch out for is with 50% coverage of concrete in the front yard.
Right.
Yeah, it would have been easier if we could see what, you know, what the final plot would be like. Because we're looking at the one that's not going to work, right?
Right.
It'd be easy if we saw the one that said, hey, this is how it would be, this would be the
right. I think it's just going to go straight out.
It'll just be straight out with the radius, you know. Come out and radius around this for a little turn in.
So where you've got the driveway drawn would be grass?
Here, this would be the door. This wall would now have the door. Likely this little pocket would come in all the way.
Do you know this
part? I got it.
Yeah, so this is just all ground. This doesn't here. This is just side yard.
Yeah, this becomes side yard.
This just goes straight.
The driveway comes all
the way. Probably shift the house where it's equally on the lot where even side yards in the back, around the sides. So it'd be maybe 12-foot side yards each way.
Right.
Maybe much more.
You gotta rack it to one side to get 20 feet on one side and 7 on the other. So you just split the difference.
Which is, yeah.
Recenter.
Yourself on side yard. So instead of a long skinny drive, you have a short wide.
Right.
Is that bump out gonna go away?
I think that'll be left in there just due to the style of the house that you built. The way the roof is designed, that little bump out would still stay.
This one here, yeah.
This little bump out.
It would actually stay in.
Yeah. Just in order to meet the garage width and depth requirements.
Motion to approve the variance for 409 Peninsula.
Okay, I have a motion. Do I have a second?
I second the motion.
Okay, motion and a second. All those in favor? Okay, thank you.
All right.
How soon do you think you're going to start, Mike?
Probably be submitted for permit in the next 2 weeks.
Oh, wow. Okay. Thanks, Mike.
Good to see you.
That's your exit key, Rod.
My exit. Thank you.
There you go. Thanks, Rod. Hey, Rod, did you submit the construction plans yet?
I did.
You did? Okay.
Yes.
All right. Yeah. Okay. All right.
He's ready to go. He was just waiting for a time.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rod.
Thank you.
Okay, next up, we have, okay, so the next up on the agenda is a rate increase requested by Republic Allied. We're not going to do that tonight. There's some, there's a calculation error, I think. We'll just kind of, we got to work out something in the document, so we're just going to pull that for now. We'll get back with that next month. So we'll deal with that then. All right, number four then is discussion of finance and audit committee ordinance. That is Liz. And Liz, you're up.
So basically, took the ordinance that was created in November and kind of took the suggestions from that meeting and made the updates to it. Linda, thank you for doing the red and the stripes because I didn't do that, so she did that for me. So you can see on item six, it was the committee will review and or recommend, but we struck out and or and just left recommend and or create financial planning for the current and future town projects, such as multi-year budget planning, short and long-term town planning. Number seven, we added the committee will request to have access to all financial records, reports, and contracts through the town secretary. So we added that we would go through Linda for access to the documents.
Can I interject?
Sure.
You know, you don't need to go to Linda to get a document. You don't have to do an open records request. You're on the city council. You already have access to it.
Well,
right, but this was...
this was the document.
For the citizens, right? So not everybody in the committee is going to be a town council person.
No, no, but right now, under Texas law, under open records, they can already see all of these things. You know, like the check register is already up on the website. You know, the like the budget is already up on the website. And if you're on this committee and you say, hey, I wonder what the Allied contract looks like, okay, you can just walk in there and take it out of the folder under the contract, make a copy of it. You already have access to all of these things.
Right, but there was an issue where Clint kind of wanted to make sure that the integrity of the documents were being kept.
No, that's true.
So this was sort of like a safeguard, I guess.
That was my concern, right? It's just making sure that the files stay as organized the way the person is.
Yeah, I guess what I'm saying is you can already go to Linda right now. Anyone in this town right now can go to Linda and say, can I please get a copy of this? This is already doable presently. That's already doable.
So you're arguing you don't even need seven?
You already can get. If you said, I would like to get a copy of the bank statement, you can already get a copy of the bank statement.
Does it hurt to have anything in it? Does it hurt anything to leave it in there?
Okay, there's no...
Sorry.
So I guess, I'm just curious.
I can see it either way. Right?
Yeah, I mean,
you're right, technically.
I guess I'm just trying to make the point that, you know, you can get whatever you want. You're not limited to whatever, articulating every single thing, like it says, multi-year planning, comma, revenues.
Number seven, right.
Yeah. It says annual budget, funding strategies, bank accounts, multi-year budget planning, revenue.
I guess access to any revenue records. I mean, I guess it's comical, Mark, but when, you know, we're creating something out of scratch, and I really don't know what the town has established and what the town doesn't have established. So I just wanted to incorporate everything in here, whether we have it or not, because we may have that in the future, or I mean, we may have it already established. So, I mean, I guess, you know, throughout this whole meetings that we've had, nobody had an issue with seven. The only issue was how a safeguard, you know, go through somebody to actually get the documents. Who's that person going to be? Can that be added into seven, you know, for the integrity of the documents? So I'm kind of taken back now that...
But that was the point. That was the point.
Yeah.
Documenting control.
Yeah.
So maybe it's not necessary. Maybe it's just the compromise is not necessarily. It's more along the lines of, I'm trying to think how to word this a lot, right? Maybe along the lines of, prior to the committee meeting, like 30 days, the request for such and whatever documents that whatever the agenda is, right?
Mm-hmm.
To give, in this case, Linda time to pull those records. And then that would meet my concern of, my concern is anybody, even if it's a council member, right? You know, when I go through those drawers, I try to be extremely careful, right? Hold out, put it back in the exact same spot.
Okay, that's fine.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
That's fine.
Right, and so I think in this time. Case, yeah, maybe that's kind of the split the difference, right? It's not so much, well, I'll take it out or leave it in, but maybe it's more of a process of like, let's not ask Linda 2 days in advance for a meeting, you know, can we have this stack of documents? Maybe it's something like that. So
I think number 8 addresses that, doesn't it?
Oh, maybe it does. Yeah, right. There you go, yeah. So maybe 7 on a meeting.
I guess, let me close, then we can move on. You know that you don't need this to access, you know, the financial records. You don't need to have this. This isn't like a requirement in order to access. You can access any records you want, any time you want. You know what I mean? I'm just making sure you understand that, you know,
actually,
this is already doable.
To Dan's point, really, if you just strike 7, 8 covers it, right?
Except for
the committee coordinates
with
the town secretary.
Specifics.
Good point. Congratulations.
And then maybe it's just a matter of adding
financial documents.
Yeah.
Pretty much good. There you go. And again, suppose that you said, you know, oh wow, it doesn't say in there that I can see a, you know, like a franchise agreement. Well, you can't, because under open records you can see franchise agreements. So, you know, even if you leave something out, you can still see it anyway. So,
my concern was the integrity, and it addresses that.
Yeah. All right.
So we just add what, financial documents to 8?
8's already got financial documents in.
Yeah.
Okay, so
it becomes everything. To Mark's point, it's just anything.
Okay.
There's no reason to list out what it is because it is anything.
Okay. And the next thing that we updated was section 3A, which is the committee shall be comprised of at least 5 but no more than 7 members. Up to 2 committee members shall be a member of the council, town council. The other 5 members shall be nominated and approved by the town council. Committee members from the community must live and have their primary residence in the town. So instead of have. They must be registered voters of the town who, to the extent possible, shall be finance professionals such as accountants, certified public accountants, auditors, or shall have equivalent experience in business expense management. So we added that business expense management there.
Okay, I guess I'm, okay, so now I'm concerned, because all the things you're trying to do, you're talking about, we're going to be ahead of it. The purpose and the duties here are to deal with the independent auditor, you're going to review and appraise the audit efforts, you're going to review budgetary policies, financial investments. But this thing you added, this qualification, is about business expense management. Why would you add that? That's, you know, basically, it was the way it was before is what Corinth has. You have to be an accountant, a CPA, or have the equivalent experience, because you're dealing with the auditor, you're dealing with budgeting, you're dealing with planning. If you're talking about expense minimization or expenses, then that's fine. Then you want people that have business experience and expenses. Okay? Because you've taken the qualifications and made them broader.
So it depends, I guess, what defines business expense management. To me, it has to do with accounting, it has to do with auditing, it has to do with budgets, it has to do with expenses. It's just more than just the word expense. Because if we just leave, shall have equivalent experience, well, what is equivalent experience?
To being a CPA or to be an auditor of equivalent, normally you'd say, or equivalent financial experience. You wouldn't limit it to expense, you'd limit it to financial, meaning revenues and expense. You know, you basically have upper band, like a CFO. Okay? If you say business expense management, that could be somebody in AP.
It was
just handling AP.
I took that as program management too.
Yeah.
The question I had on that, is that in response to, I think last month we had a discussion about actually trying to, I mean, it's a small pool of residents, right?
Mm-hmm.
Actually trying to broaden it out a little bit.
To define, I guess, what equates to equivalent experience, right?
Right, because that was part of the reason why it went from 7 members to 5, right? Because
we were trying to.
And so that's why that was added, to try to kind of broaden the potential pool, I guess, of candidates.
Or I guess we can just add the shall have equivalent financial experience.
I like that.
That's.
Yeah, because you've got a conundrum here a little bit in that you've got the responsibilities are this big, and now you're trying to find the people or qualifications, and there's a tension there, right? Because if the pool is got these qualifications, then maybe they can't do all these responsibilities. Or if you want all these responsibilities, like dealing with the auditor, if you really believe you're going to evaluate the auditor, you have to be an auditor.
Well, no.
You have to know what auditing is. You have to know what auditing procedures are to evaluate the auditor. You have to know how to do an audit to evaluate the auditor.
You have to know how to do an audit, but you don't to actually have a degree,
no,
or
but,
be an
but
auditor.
I've done
tons of auditings, and I don't have a title that says that I'm an auditor.
If you don't know how an audit is performed, if you don't understand the auditing rules, then you're in no position to evaluate what the auditor's doing. The auditor has to follow auditing rules. So for instance, you might not understand why he made that balance sheet the way he did. You might not like the way that it's formatted, you might think that you ought to have different categories. You don't understand that he can't do that. He's not allowed to do that. The auditing standards make him do it a certain way.
But those auditing standards are public, and that can be researched and that can be learned.
To that extent. I'm using that as an example to say, for instance, if you really want to deal with auditing stuff, you have to have auditing experience. You have to have experience dealing with auditors. You just don't have the capability.
Well,
that's two different things.
So I'm just, let me go back to our original point. If you want to set the objective first, which is we want to cover all of these things from soup to nuts for the responsibilities, then you have to make sure the qualifications you have are sufficient to be able to handle the soup to nuts. Or you've got to tweak it. Does that make sense?
That makes sense, but I think you're presuming that I am not capable of knowing if an auditor is qualified or not.
Liz, you didn't know what the opinion letter was on the podium last month.
Let's stay focused.
I did know what the opinion was.
Okay, so let's move on.
So, Liz, I got a question for you. The volunteer group.
Yeah.
Elizabeth? Yes.
I just got a question on that. Was your intent here to say you got to have some financial experience so that you can evaluate? And this is
yes,
public
that
information.
Was the intent.
They're not spending any money, right? A lot of us have dealt with auditors on both sides of the equation, right? Does the verbiage bother you? Does it need to be, did you want it broader? Or are you good with business expense management, or do you want just business management? What works better for you? Because I mean, to Mark's point, maybe we just take the word expense out, and it's a little bit broader, and then we can move on.
I thought she suggested dropping that phrase and including financial experience.
Yeah, you can almost just get rid of that.
I'll just strike the whole phrase, and I'll just add financial experience.
Perfect.
On the next, we added all appointed committee members shall serve a term of 2 years and shall be reappointed by the town council every 2 years. Terms will be staggered with odd numbers on odd years and even numbers on even years. So this was something that was suggested last time.
Kind of keeps,
there's no limitation.
It doesn't turn over
at once. Yeah, but here's the problem. You can't say shall. You got to say may. You can't tie another city council to force them to reappoint someone. You cannot do that.
No.
We know you can't do that. So it can't be a shall. It's got to be a may. You can't make the city council in 2 years have to reappoint someone.
Shall appoints.
Yeah. Shall's got to be better do.
Doesn't the MDD say shall?
I'm pretty sure it does.
So, you understand. That's one of those general rules that Andy always tells us. We can never bind somebody going forward.
And then section 4C, we removed all the wording after quarter because I think that, yeah. I mean, it's...
That cleans it up. It's good.
Was determined that if people were going to be part of the committee that they would attend, so... we added D, the members of the committee shall serve without compensation. Anything on that? And then... the other thing was that we just, I fixed the severability clause. I removed the other one that was in there that I guess wasn't appropriate.
Okay. Let me ask you a general question, Liz, because I must have seen it, but I kind of. So, this section 5B talks about. Committee members are not council members, except for council, okay. Shall have no additional voting rights in town matters outside of the community. Is there any voting going on here?
So it was intended for the committee to have a vote to proceed to present, or the chairman to present the ideas or the recommendations to the town council.
Is that their mechanism for coming up with consensus to what's going to be presented to the council?
I'm sorry?
That would be their mechanism of coming up with a consensus as to what will be presented to the council.
Exactly. It's not that they're going to, you know, vote to actually put anything in place. It's just a vote to, is there everybody in agreement to actually take this to the town council?
Okay, is that in here? Did I miss it?
Well, that's what B is intended for.
Okay, so B says that, I read B to say that
we've got some things going on.
The board members are not council members. So you don't, you know, board members can't vote on council stuff. That's the way I interpreted B. There's no additional voting rights in town matters.
Right.
Board members don't get to vote here tonight on what we're talking about. Right? They don't have additional voting rights.
Right, they don't. Yeah, they don't.
But is there something in here that says procedures, you know, the committee shall vote on moving something forward, or I don't see anything in here that says that the committee is actually going to vote on anything.
Well, maybe they don't, right? It's really up to the committee and how we operate. And that's the way
I thought there was something like that last time.
That's why I didn't see it somewhere.
I don't think in the last six or seven revisions of this, every month we've seen the ingredient, we've actually told them exactly how to run the committee. I think the idea was to put the people together, have them figure out, and then bring the suggestions to the council.
Yeah, I mean,
I thought that
what you're suggesting then is like having their own charter or their own mission statement.
They can figure it out. Right.
That's what I have.
Or maybe I removed it off of this.
Well, here's my future concern. My future concern is that you have to tell Andy how you're going to operate. Because if you're taking votes, Andy might say, that's a problem. Because now you're looking like a quasi-government. It looks like we're delegating. It's something with Andy. Andy needs to know if they're just going to say, is everybody okay with this? You know, or are you actually going to have a recorded vote? Because you're going to be taking minutes. You know, I think Andy needs to know that. Because I know in my reading of some of the law stuff, that's one of those distinguishing things. If you're voting on something, there's actually a vote, that makes it look like it's a government agency. Like, you know, the Parks Board doesn't vote on anything. You guys chat about it and say, you know, this is what we think we ought to do next. But nobody's making motions or voting, so that's why that's just advisory. And I know with some of the law stuff with Andy, that triggers things when you start voting. Because then it looks like potentially the city council's delegating to you something, you're voting on it.
So if we go completely the other way and assume that the committee comes up with their own operating procedures and how they're going to, is B even needed?
Well, B's a limitation. All B does is limit outside the committee. Inside the committee is just like you said for the Parks and Rec Committee. They can do what they want to do, it's just an advisory board.
But like if you look at Corinth is very specific.